My name is Lena. I'm going to talk about Nudge Health and how can something like feature toggle help you to come out of it. So let's start with the story of Team X, a team at a startup which got recently funded. And because of that, they were able to hire a lot of people, quite a few people, and they are looking forward for a major release, the first release after they got funded. So a lot of eyes on to them, and the team is excited because they are because they are doing a major release after they got funded, and there are a lot of importance for that. And the second one is that their customers have been waiting for some of the major features, which they were not able to release because of lack of people. And now they are trying to release it. And then the entire team is very excited. And they want to be very careful. So they created small teams, the so-called agile pizza team, one pizza team, and to make sure that they had continuous integration set up among each team, and they had automated testing to make sure that there are no regression issues, and they were fine. They were committing to the feature branches. They continued like that, and then they started integrating because the release date is close, and then they had time for integration, and then and merging to the master and releasing. And when that time came, the situation was different. There were a lot of fights, not fight with each other. Fight was with the code base, especially because they had a very long living branches, and they had to fix a lot of merge conflicts, and that resulted in regression issues. Tests started failing. Their confidence started coming down because they had a lot of confidence because of the automated test that came down because they were not sure what they were doing. They were just fixing things and moving on. And the team which were looking forward for the release, and then the bugs also came in, which the team which were looking forward for the release, they're trying to run away from that, and then they definitely missed the deadline. That's for sure. And finally they made a release, but which was very none of the team was happy. So the investors were very curious. Okay, what is happening? Business team and the sales team, they were very very furious. Okay, why in the world something like this happens? And the team is totally demotivated. And so I think most of you might be familiar with such a situation. Not exactly the same situation, but somewhat similar to the situation where the end time of a release takes a tremendous amount of time. Until then, the feature complete gets done, but never goes to production. I think one style or the other, we all of us would have faced it in the past. And so let's see what went wrong with them. And for us to analyze that, first let's look at what is continuous integration. This is the explanation. This is what is written in Wikipedia. This is how Wikipedia explains continuous integration. I have highlighted the key terms over here. That is, it's a practice of merging all developer working copies to a shared mainline several times a day. So what happened with Team X was they never had a shared mainline, and they were not merging to that mainline several times a day. And that is where it went wrong. And that is where mainline development came into picture. Prem in the morning spoke about how they do things at Etsy, where everyone commits to mainline. And this is one of the key thing for a proper continuous integration setup. So mainline development is or trunk-based development is where the entire team commits to a single branch, which you call as master or trunk, whatever name you call it, and then that particular branch is ready for deploy at any moment of time. And the continuous integration runs against that, and it gives you the feedback that, okay, is it ready for deploy or not? And that's a huge confidence boost for any team. Because we have something in your front, and it tells you, okay, this is ready, is there anything wrong? And you don't have to do any other kind of merging or anything to make sure that you have a ready branch for a production release. But then the question arises, how do you handle incomplete features which takes longer time? Are we expecting it to finish in a pace that is not reasonable? And of course not, and that is where feature toggle comes into picture. Feature toggle also, many team calls it with different names, feature flips, feature switches, feature flags, etc. The concept is an ability for you to turn off a feature depending on a criteria. That criteria can be either the environment in which it runs, or it can be a certain kind of thing like a certain set of users or certain geographical location, etc. So we'll talk about more in detail about different types of feature toggles coming in the rest of the talk. So this is how it looks like. It's a Ruby code. Of course, I know what you're thinking. We have if else. That's an anti-pattern, but it really works. So you have a check whether a certain flag is true, then you do a certain kind of execution, otherwise you do something else. And that is how a feature toggle works. And you can do it through configuration files, either YAML files or a property file, which depending upon what kind of framework or language you are using. And using that you can do, or there are quite a few open source tools available across languages which you can use for feature toggles. That depends how do you want to take it forward. For example, rollout is a very very popular one in the Ruby world. Toggles is another one in the Java world, and so on and so forth. So I pick some and put it over here, and but I'm sure it is available in across all the languages. And so usually most of the teams, at least in my experience, the toggle starts off as release toggles, a way to segregate your deployment from releases. You are ready to deploy at any moment of time, but that doesn't mean that you are releasing. And that gives you confidence that, okay, you always have the confidence that the feature which is not ready, either because it's incomplete or it requires certain acceptance from some major stakeholders, the code is still there, but it's not open to the users. And this allows another facility that is you can, if you want to push a quick patch or a bug fix to the production, what you can do is you can follow the same process. You don't have to create another branch for that or merge with that, and then it goes through the same code, and then there is no question of developers merging into a certain branch and then rebasing it and so on and so forth. And another thing that I have I personally have seen is that you can keep the toggle until you get some kind of a confidence, and say you push something to production, and then you see some unexpected behaviors in production. Instead of rolling back the entire code, which is ideally the case that should happen, but until you get to that level of maturity, you can do what you can do is you can turn off the feature and deploy another one, and then the production is taken care. The thing is that the feature is not available to user, but it is much better than a situation where it affects 100% of the user because of load in the server or some misbehaviors in the server. So that's another advantage that you get with this. And there are a couple of other types of feature toggles. Multiple people spoke about this in multiple talks. One such thing is called A/B testing, where you can open up the feature to a certain set of users, depending upon a certain condition, such as depending on a geography or say age group or so and so forth. So the difference between release toggle and experiment toggles is that experiment toggles are based on certain criteria, usually based on the user's criteria. Release toggle is usually based on the environment in which it runs. Usually in all pre-production environments it will be turned off, and in production environment the toggle will be turned off. And so, but that's the difference between the experimental toggle and release toggle. Another technique that we can use is canary releasing. That also some speakers spoke about it. That is, instead of opening up the features to the entire user base, you can gradually open it to users. The advantage that you get, one is like the A/B testing, where you can see or say monitor how users are using it, tune it accordingly, and you can quickly run another experiment to see how people are using it now, or you can decide okay what next step to take on that particular feature. And another way canary releasing is used is to test your architecture or your infrastructure. So rather than opening up to the entire user base, you can open up to a certain set of users and see how your system behaves. And depending upon that, you can tune and optimize for further load. And that's another advantage that you get by having feature toggles as a setup in your development process. And there is a third type of toggles called ops toggles. Ops toggles is a way to manage your manually manage your circuit breakers. For example, let's take a case of a shopping site or an e-commerce site where you have recommendations. Say because of a unexpected failure in the system, the recommendation engine is not behaving, is taking too much load on the system. It can be because of network failure or a hardware failure. So what you can do is you can turn off that feature until you completely restore the service. And for those kinds of things also, this comes under the circuit breakers. When something doesn't respond within a time you expect, you break it and move on. And the feature toggles gives you the flexibility for that too. And that is how you can use feature toggles also. So even though we started off the talk with saying that, okay, how can you push incomplete features to production, these are added advantages that you get by having a setup for feature toggles. So when Prem spoke about the feature toggle in the morning, many people were talking about how do you handle the if-else in your code. And so that's a side I'm going to talk about. So every practice or everything that you do has a pro and con. So nothing is perfect. So likewise, feature toggle. So this is an actual feature toggle that we had in our system. This is not something I made up. So once we had these many feature toggles, people forgot to remove. Ideally, feature toggle has to be short-living. But that ideal situation doesn't happen all the time because of various reasons. So we sat and deleted all the feature toggles. You can imagine the permutation and combination of if-else that code might have had at that point of time. So we sat and removed it. So how do you handle it? This is not much different from asking the question, how do you create less bugs, or how do you handle your technical debt? There is no goal. There is nothing like, okay, you do this, this will happen. And similarly, feature toggle also. So to manage that, only one guideline, in my experience, which has worked, is that set a guideline for the expiry date for every toggle. So once you create it, say that, okay, it has to be deleted by this time. That can be a standard across the team, or it can be depending upon certain condition, depending upon the complexity of the feature. And over a period of time, what I've seen is that it matures in within the team. Okay, so recently I've read, which this is something that I've not tried myself, that certain teams have created build scripts which will fail if the feature toggle is beyond the expiry date. You can go to that level. But I've not tried that, but that seems to be a very good way. In that way, it is completely handled automatically. But it requires some time for you to actually say, okay, what is the expiry date? Is it 2 days? Is it 1 week? Or is it two weeks? So you experiment it and see. Usually, if you give time, this is like test-driven development or say pair programming. It takes time, so you work with people, converse openly, and then I think almost all the time, this kind of things will be taken care of over a period of time. And Another thing that I would like to emphasize is that I started with TeamX, which is a team within a company. So I'm not saying that this is the way to go in an open source world. So open in GitHub workflow works perfectly fine in an open source world, because there it is open and you need some kind of a control with what kind of code goes into the code goes into the code base. And that is because there is no hiring mechanism, so called. So and it requires that kind of a control. And versus that, in the product team where the importance should be given to the code going into the production and see how it behaves, rather than making sure that you are taking care of the coding guidelines or the design principles. The best feedback that you can get is by going the code into the production and that and how users use it. And if it doesn't make sense, just remove it. That's the best thing that should be done, rather than waiting for someone to review the code and approve it. And you have tools like Linding and so many other things that you can do to take care of, automate that too, and to automate, offload that process much earlier rather than later in the design, later in the release cycle. And have conversation within the team, have understanding among the team to say, okay, this is the kind of guidelines that you follow. So, but just to emphasize, I'm not talking about open source over here. I'm talking about just teams which are working toward a product team, where it makes complete sense. At least that is what I've seen. It works. And just to summarize, have a proper continuous integration setup. That is, follow mainline development, where every member in the team commits to the same branch. And in what I've seen is that this is a first major step towards continuous delivery or continuous deployment. Without having a proper continuous integration setup, it is not possible. It is very hard, maybe bordering on to impossible, to have a proper continuous delivery or deployment setup, closely followed by automation. But this is a first step. And use feature toggle, segregate deployment from releases. Use feature toggles for that. Run quick experiments within the production to see, okay, how users use the features, and use feature toggles for that too. And set an expiry date so that the feature toggles doesn't become a technical debt. And this is a regenerated TeamX. They learned from their failure. They didn't give up. And now they are happy because they can see when their code goes into production. And that makes them very, very confident and very, very accomplished. And I think that's it. Yeah, just an emphasis on the references. The first link I have given, I'll be sharing the slides. The first reference I have given, an article in Martifolio's site. It talks very in detail about feature toggles, how do you manage it, what is the use of each types of feature toggles. So anyone who wants to start with feature toggles, I highly recommend you to read that. A couple of other blog posts that I've written, and this is my contact.
Questions?
We have time for questions?
We have time for one question.
Seems.
Nice talk. How do you define like expiry time for a feature toggle? I didn't get that part.
So what we have used is that we have our the ticketing system or a project management system. So we add another card saying that, okay, we have to delete this feature toggle by this date. You can have reminders. Or sometimes what we have done is that in the whiteboard, you write, okay, this feature toggle has to be removed by this date. And when you're having stand-ups or say any other meetings, people get notified about that. So that depends. And then how long I'm a consultant, so I have the standard answer, it depends. You have to try out and see what works. Until you get the confidence in the production. So that's the way to get started. Over a period of time, I think it come automatically. So did that answer your question? Okay.